Welcome to Free Christian Church of God's video outreach ministry, bringing the gospel message of Jesus Christ into your home each and every Sunday morning. If you would like more information about the video ministry or other ministries that we have to offer, stay tuned immediately following this program. And now, open your Bibles and follow along as we bring you today's message.
Jonah chapter 1, stand your feet, lift your Bible in the air and say it along with me. You can't find it, we'll put it on the screen. You can read it, all right? Jonah chapter 1, let's say it with me. This is my Bible, it's God's infallible word. I am who it says I am. I have what it says I have, and I can do what it says I can do. Today, I'll be taught the word of God. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the word of God. My mind is alert, my heart is receptive, and I will never be the same in Jesus' name. You will not be the same when God's word gets a hold of you. You can't help but not be the same. Jonah chapter 1, verse 3. But Jonah ran away from the Lord, and he headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port, and after paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. God, I pray for your anointing to be all over this word today. Lord, there are people here today who need to be saved. There are people here today who want to be saved. They want to get away from the life that they've had. They want to get away from their past. They want a new start. And God, you offer that to them. Jesus Christ went to the cross to pay for every person's sin, no matter how bad they are, and to break the curse that caused that sin. And God, I pray today that your Holy Spirit will speak to people's hearts, that they will know that this is a place where they can meet with you. God, this is a place where their life can be changed. God, know that the people that are around here aren't going to stare them down or wonder what it is they've done wrong, because God, a whole lot of us, we're in the same boat. God, we get down on our knees and we repented and we asked for you to become our Lord and Savior. And God, I pray you have that same work in the lives of many in this congregation today. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. King David said in Psalm 139, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" There is no escaping God. David said, knew from the pleasant and the unpleasant experiences of his life that it was a useless effort to try to escape from the presence of the Lord. Throughout his life, David had tried running away from God, but it never worked. He tried hiding from God, but God always found him. He tried to disguise himself, but God always knew who he was. David understood that there was nowhere that he could go to escape the all-seeing, all-knowing presence of God. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? The Bible informs us that God is omnipresent. That means that God is everywhere at all times. God is in the past, he is in the present, and he is in the future, and he sees it all as a present reality. God is in Jerusalem, he's in Moscow, he's in Beijing and Washington, D.C., and he's here with us today because God, and only God, has the ability to be everywhere at once. He's also omniscient, meaning that he knows all things and there isn't anything that he doesn't know. Nothing ever takes God by surprise. He never miscalculates or makes any mistakes. He can't be outwitted or taken advantage of because there isn't anything that God doesn't know. The Bible also teaches us that God is omnipotent, meaning that he is all powerful and sovereignly in control. No one outranks him. No one can overpower him. He can't be overthrown or impeached, and he will never resign. There is no one like our God. There is nowhere that we can go to escape him. We can't avoid him. We can't elude him. We can't escape his sight. We can't dodge his influence. And we can't avoid his blessing or his judgment. There is no escaping God. You may not want to deal with God. You might try to keep God in the Bible and try to keep the church out of your life. You might tell people, talk to the hand because I have it all figured out and I'm not interested in what you have to say, but there will come a day when you will have to deal with God because he's going to make you deal with him. You won't be able to escape him. When God calls a meeting with you, you are not going to miss your appointment. Everything that we know and believe in this life is based upon our perception of God. What we know and believe about God influences every other component of our life. Everything that we know about this life, everything that we know about marriage and about family and about relationships, everything that we know about love and work and finances and a million other things is based upon how we perceive God. You see, God is at the core of our being. We were created in His image and in His likeness. His fingerprints are all over us, and His mark is etched on our soul. We can deny Him. We can claim that we're an atheist. We can tell the world that He doesn't exist, but we all still bear God's signature. We can ignore Him, but we can't avoid Him. We can deny Him, but we cannot escape Him. So if our perception of God is wrong, then it would only stand to reason that everything else in our life is going to be wrong. If our image of God is skewed or perverted, then everything else in our life will not line up or make any sense. The troubles that we are dealing with in our world today are because many people perceive God in the wrong light. Some people deny His existence, and they live their life like there is no God, and there is no sin, and there's no salvation or no judgment. Other people view God as they wish to see Him. They perceive God as a power source that they can tap into, or a magical fairy who's only here to serve them and do their bidding. Many people perceive God as they want God to be, but not as the Bible describes Him to be. And the result is the ongoing mess that they call their life. But there's going to come a day in our life when we will see God as He is. He will confront us. He will stop us in our tracks and make us deal with Him, because there is no escaping God. Have you ever watched a police chase on TV? Do you watch these? I find them entertaining. I don't know why. Probably because I'm old. My attention span's short. But it's always the same way. There's this wise guy who's done something wrong, so he decides that he's going to get away from the law. Already you know he's a genius. So what does he do? He starts thinking, I can do this. I can do this. So he goes and he jumps into his car, and one car that he's stolen, and he starts on this 100-mile-an-hour chase away from the police. He runs down freeways, and he goes through neighborhoods, and he goes wrong way down one-way streets, putting innocent people in danger all of the time. Now, there are police cars at every intersection. There's a helicopter in the air, and the TV cameras are monitoring every move that he makes. He never once leaves their side, and everybody knows that it's only a matter of time before the law catches up to him. And yet he continues to run. While we sit at home, we watch it on our TV and say to ourselves, how stupid can somebody be? David said, if I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in the grave, you're there. If I take the wings of the morning and I sail to the uttermost parts of the sea, you're there. There is no escaping your presence. David wasn't complaining. He wasn't frustrated with the feeling that God was shadowing him or dogging his trail, but David took comfort in God's universal presence, understanding that the omnipresence of God was a blessing and not a threat. David said, even in the most remote experiences of my life, not just when I obey you and I'm doing good, but even when I turn my back on you and I'm running away, your hand still leads me and your right hand still holds me. God is a sovereign God. That means that He is always in control. Even when it appears that everything is out of control, God is still God. Even when we don't want Him to be in control, even when we don't want to hear from Him or have a relationship with Him, God is still God. But sometimes we like to run. We're like the guy in the police chase. We get into our little getaway car and we take off and go as fast as we can go, but we soon find out that no matter where we go, God is there. When the Holy Spirit convicts us about how we're living, we're sometimes tempted to think that we know better than God. Now, we know how God wants us to live, and we know what He wants us to do with our life, but we're so bullheaded and so stubborn and so set in our ways that we're going to do things our way anyway. How's that working for you? The devil is your only enemy. Listen to me. Your fight isn't against God. Your fight isn't against flesh and blood, because the devil is your only adversary, and he is smarter than you. Now, he's no match for God, but he does have your number. He can outthink you, and he can outmaneuver you and outplan you. And when you run away from God and you turn a deaf ear to the Holy Spirit, the devil's going to start talking to you. And he's going to tell you, like the guy in the police chase, you can do this. When you ignore the voice of God, the devil will begin speaking to you. He'll give you good reasons why you don't need to listen to God. And if you continue to ignore God and listen to the devil, he'll begin a destructive cycle in your life. He will justify every bad decision that you make and every bad relationship that you get into until he lures you into a place where you are totally vulnerable. It's then that your fuse will be short. Your temper will take over. You'll cry and you'll get angry and you'll scream because your mind isn't being controlled by the Holy Spirit. Good decisions will start looking like bad decisions, and bad decisions will start looking like good ones. Satan will lure you further and further from where you should be until you find yourself somewhere that you should not be. Your emotions will take control of you. You're an emotional being, but God also gave you a mind to discern right and wrong. But the devil will lure you into a place where you stop using your mind. You will act like an animal on instinct. You'll just react. He'll lure you into a place where you no longer think clearly and discern the facts of what's happening around you, but you'll impulsively and blindly leap into your own destruction. Ultimately, you'll find yourself stranded in a place of bondage, in a place of depression. You'll no longer have any self-esteem or self-worth. You'll be unfulfilled and unhappy and no longer know which way to turn. You'll view your life as a failure, and you're a loser, and you have no hope. It's then that death will appear to be a viable option. You no longer contribute anything worthwhile, so you figure if you came up missing, nobody would really care. You start believing that if you were dead, everybody else's life would probably improve. The devil has you right where he wants you. Your actions have put innocent people in danger. Satan has lined up his targets so he can take out more than one at a time. He's not only going to destroy you, but he's also going to destroy everything that God had planned for you. He'll wipe out your divine destiny, and he'll use it as a stepping stone to do the same to those who you are supposed to touch with your life. He'll get to your husband. He'll get to your wife. He will then get to your children and maybe even your grandchildren. And it's all because you tried to run from God. Maybe you're there right now. Maybe what I just described to you is your life. But I want you to know something. God still has his hand on you. Somebody needs to hear this. You don't really know God. You don't understand how big God is and how powerful he is, and you don't know how much God really loves you. Satan has led you into a valley of destruction. He has lied to you, but God still has his hand on you. He has never let go of you. He still has a plan for your life, and one way or another, he is going to bring you back. God said to Jonah, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." God knows who needs to be preached to. God knows who needs to hear the gospel. Jesus said in Luke 5:32, "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." In Luke 19:10, Jesus said, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." You know, I might preach to church people on Sunday morning because God knows there are some church people who are still lost and need to be saved. But there's a reason that our congregation sponsors television programs and radio programs only on secular channels. There's a reason that we put our message out to the world over the internet. There's a reason why we're building churches in foreign lands where there are no churches. And it's because we have been commissioned to preach the saving gospel to the lost and dying world. God said, "Arise, Jonah, get up. I have something for you to do." Don't you hate those words? When a wife walks in, you're still asleep. "Get up! Got something for you to do today." You just want to hide, don't you? If you're ever going to make anything out of your life, you have to get up from where you are and move when God tells you to move. You can't start being the person you want to be until you stop being the person that you are. You won't get anywhere until you get up. Your chains won't fall off until you get up. You can't change, or God can't use you until you get the energy and the tenacity and the vision to break from the status quo and do something different with your life. God has a divine call on you. He has an assignment for you. He has a plan and charted a course for your life that's going to take you to your divine destiny. He's given you directions and instructions that you're to follow, but to know and understand the plan that God has for you, you have to listen closely for His voice. You have to turn down the volume of other things so you can clearly and distinctly hear what God is saying to you. You see, too many people are looking for a sign. They want to see the sky open up and hear angels singing. They want a voice of God to thunder from a shrub in their backyard. They like to look out back and see a lightning bolt or see the water in their swimming pool part down the middle. They want something big. They want something spectacular. They want something that will drown out the noise and the volume of their life. They think that if God's going to speak to them, that He has to get their attention first. But God isn't obligated to get your attention. You're obligated to get His. You need to learn, as the prophet Elijah learned, that sometimes God isn't in the great wind that breaks up the mountains. Sometimes God isn't in the earthquake that shakes the ground you're standing on. Sometimes He's not in the fire that consumes the things that are around you, but He is that still small voice whispering to your spirit, "Here I am, and this is what I want you to do." God can't direct your steps if you're not willing to move your feet. God said, "Jonah, get up. This is what I want you to do." But Jonah responded like some of us. He said, "I can't and I won't." Have you ever told God no? It takes a lot of nerve and a whole lot of stupidity to stand in God's face and tell Him no. As far as we know from the Bible, Jonah was the only true prophet who disobeyed a direct commission from God to prophesy. I guess the other prophets probably had more sense than that, but there was something deep in Jonah that rebelled against God's call for his life. You might already know what God wants you to do with your life. You've heard His voice calling you to rise up, and He's shown you the direction He wants you to go, but there's something deep inside of you that's standing in your way, and you're refusing to move. Jonah had a past. There's one thing that's common to all of us here today. We all have a past. There isn't a person sitting in this sanctuary who doesn't have a past. There isn't one of us who doesn't have baggage that we have accumulated over the years. We are all carrying something that we don't need. We are all carrying something that is weighing us down and holding us back. We are all carrying something that is a detriment to our destiny. We all have a past that sometimes gets in our way. We can't move forward because of something that is in our rearview mirror. There's an anchor in our past that's restraining us from reaching forward to our destiny. We're wasting days and years of our life not doing what God has created us for, marinating in memories and not obeying God's command to move forward because of something buried in the archives of our life. Maybe it's a past sin that we've committed. And we think it's too bad for God to forgive us or too bad for God to forget about. Or maybe something terrible that somebody else has done to us. We were victimized and we can't let go of it. But until we shed whatever it is, until we take it off, we will just sit and waste the life God has given us doing nothing. Jonah had a past. The Ninevites, the people that God wanted Jonah to preach to, were Assyrians. And the Assyrians were ruthless people. When they conquered a city or a people, it wasn't just a military act. But the Assyrians were the original terrorists. They wouldn't just kill the soldiers that fought against their soldiers, but they would slay innocent victims. They would burn young men at the stake. They would burn young women in bonfires. They would impale other people on stakes and behead city leaders and pile their skulls at the city gates. They adorned themselves with necklaces strung from the toes of their victims. They were even known to peel the skin from their victims and hang them as trophies on the walls in their homes. The Ninevites were a horrible people. This was part of Jonah's past, 50 years before the time of Jonah. Shalmaneser, an Assyrian king, wrote an inscription of his hideous achievements on Mount Carmel. But on his way to Mount Carmel, he stopped by this little town called Gethsepher. And he victimized the people that lived there. Gethsepher was Jonah's hometown. Jonah's hometown, Jonah's family, Jonah's friends. Jonah had a past that was keeping him from obeying God, and his past led to a prejudice. Prejudices always begin with a justifiable reason. Nobody just decides one day that they're going to hate somebody else. There has to first be a reason for their hate. But I want you to know there's always a reason. You will always find a reason, and often that reason is passed on from generation to generation until the truth of it gets buried in tradition. The Hatfields are feuding with the McCoys, the Capulets are fighting with the Montagues, but none of them know why they're fighting. They just know that they're supposed to. Are there people in your life that you hate? Don't raise your hand. Just because you're supposed to hate them, you hate them? Are there prejudices that you carry that you've been taught to you and handed down to you? Is there somebody that you hate because you're supposed to hate them, but you really don't have any idea why? There are people today outside of the church who hate the church because somebody that they trusted told them that they're supposed to hate the church. Somebody told them that the Christians are hypocrites and the church is a temple of lies. They hate God's church because they're supposed to, but they have no idea why. Jonah had been trained all of his life to hate these people. They were his mortal enemies. They killed his family and destroyed his hometown. How could God possibly want to save somebody like that? Why would God want to forgive them? So Jonah began to think of countless reasons why he wasn't obligated to obey the voice of God. Jonah's past led him to a prejudice that then led Jonah to a problem. Is there anyone in your life that you don't want God to forgive? I want you to think about this a little bit. Is there anybody in your life, in your past, that you don't want God to forgive? Is there anybody from your past or anyone in your life today that you despise? They've hurt you or they have hurt somebody that you love and you hate them. Now, you won't come right out and say that you hate them. And if somebody asks you, you'll be a good Christian and say, oh, I love everybody because I love all people. But you know deep down in your heart, if you had your way, they would die and burn in hell for eternity because they deserve that kind of fate. You hate them. We're heading into an uncomfortable place here. We're tampering with a locked door in the back of your mind. We're going somewhere that you have marked off limits. We're opening the baggage that you've been carrying. But listen to me. You'll never be free until you deal with your past in the light of God's wisdom. What if God told you that he wanted you to go and witness to that person that you hate and share with them God's message of forgiveness? You see, Jonah didn't realize it, but he was trapped in a prison that he had built for his enemies. He was keeping himself from fulfilling God's plan for his life. Jonah might as well have died 50 years earlier with all of the others because he wasn't living now. He was still living in the past. There are some things that you need to let go of if you are ever going to fulfill your divine destiny. There's a time to cast some things away. There's a time to bury some things that no longer matter. You will never get past your past until you let go of it and move on. You may already know what God wants you to do with your life, but there's something deep within you that's standing in your way. You have a past that Satan is continually throwing up in your face, and your past has become a wall that stands between you and where God wants you to be. The devil's speaking to you, and he's giving you countless reasons why you shouldn't obey the voice of God. He's telling you that you can't do what God is asking you to do. Your past has led you to a prejudice that's steering you from where God wants you to go, and your prejudice is about to give you one whale of a problem because you cannot escape God. Verse 3 says, but Jonah rose up to flee. He rose up to flee from the presence of the Lord. Jonah got up like God told him to. But once he was on his feet, his past led him to a prejudice that was about to lead him to a problem, and Jonah turned away from God's will for his life. The word says that Jonah went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish, and he paid the fare thereof, and he went down into the bottom of the ship to get away from the presence of the Lord. When God spoke, Jonah rose up, but then he took off in the exact opposite direction that God wanted him to go. He went down to Joppa. When you run away from God's plan for your life, it's a downhill journey. Every step that you take away from him is one step deeper in the valley. you run, the lower it's going to get until one day you wake up to find that you've hit rock bottom. I've seen a lot of people hit rock bottom. But I've lived long enough and I have pastored long enough to know that with some people, rock bottom isn't bottom enough. I prayed with families and counseled with individuals who can't understand why their loved one who has hit bottom doesn't change. They thought that the impact would wake them up. They thought that the crash of their life on the rocks would get their attention. But even after they hit bottom, there's no change. They just hit the bottom and they stay there. Now they live with the bottom dwellers. They don't even come back to the surface. They show no interest in coming to the light. They've hit rock bottom, but bottom isn't bottom enough. Why would anybody do that? When you're as low as you possibly can go and the only other direction you can have in your life is upward, why would you choose to stay down? There's only one reason, and that reason is pride. Proverbs 11:2 says, when pride comes, then comes disgrace. In Psalm 10, the Bible says, in his pride, the wicked man does not seek him. In all his thoughts, there's no room for God. Proverbs 16 says, pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. In Proverbs 29, it tells us pride brings a person low. You know that you have been wrong. And you know what you need to change, but you are too stubborn to admit it. Your pride is keeping you in your mess. It's holding you in your valley, but you just stay there, wasting your life away. Jonah went down to Joppa and he found a ship and he paid the fare. You see, Jonah found a more efficient way to get away from where God wanted him to be. But that's kind of our nature. The vices of sin aren't only destructive, but they're also progressive. We run away from God and we crawl down into the valley and then we look for ways to destroy ourselves. We become addicted and one addiction leads to another more powerful, more deadly addiction that destroys us more efficiently. And we pay the price, we foot the bill for our own demise. Why did Jonah do what he did? It was bad enough that he'd rebelled against God's call in his life, but why did he board a ship to run even further away from God? Verse 3 tells us real plain. It says he was running away from the Lord. You see, our perception of God affects every aspect of our life, and if we choose to turn away from him, we can only expect things to get worse. What are you running away from today? Are you running away from God's plan for your life? Are you running away from your responsibility as a husband and a father? Are you running away from your responsibility to be a godly wife and mother? Are you running away from the man or the woman that God wants you to be? Jonah boarded his ship, and he went down into the bottom of it. He went as low as he could go, and he thought he was safe. He thought that maybe now God would forget about him. Maybe now God would just change his mind and leave him alone. But what Jonah didn't understand was when he fled to Joppa, God was there. When he boarded a ship, God was on the ship. When he went down into the cargo hold, out of the light of day and into the darkness, God was there. God's hand was still leading him, and his right hand was still holding him. God wasn't about to sit idly by and allow his prophet to avoid doing what he commanded him to do. Jonah had rebelled against God's call in his life, and there was going to be a storm. God hurled a wind of tremendous force at the sea that day. It was so intense that the waves pounded against the ship and threatened to break it into pieces. The story of Jonah is telling us that sometimes God is willing to send a storm into our life to turn us in the right direction. Amos chapter 3, verses 5 and 6 says, does a bird fall into a trap on the ground when there is no bait in it? Does a trap spring up from the earth when it captures nothing at all? If a trumpet is blown in a city, will not the people tremble? If a calamity occurs in a city, has not the Lord done it? Sometimes God will send a storm. Expect a storm. If you're running away from God, expect a storm. He loves you enough, and he's not going to let you go, so expect a storm. He's determined enough for you to live in his will that he won't allow you to have smooth sailing. Expect a storm. Don't be surprised when the winds begin to blow. Don't be surprised when the waves break over your bow. Don't be surprised when your little escape ship begins to break up. You can't escape God, so expect a storm. But understand this. even in your storm, God is still in control. Jonah had put everybody in danger. His actions put everybody in danger, but the ship that should have broken up and sunk didn't, because God was still in control. The crew, the sailors who should have drowned in the sea, didn't drown because God was still in control. The cargo that should have been jettisoned and lost at the bottom of the sea wasn't lost because God was still in control. Jonah didn't expect mercy from God. He had no desire to pray to God and ask for forgiveness. He had no thought of calling on God for help because he knew this was all his fault. He was the one that had run away. He was the one that disobeyed. He was the one that created this mess. He wasn't the man of God that he should be. This was all his fault, and he deserved what he was about to get. But what Jonah didn't know was that even though he wasn't the man of God that he should be, it didn't change who God was. Somebody needs to shout right there. You've already practiced. It didn't change who God was. No matter how far you run, no matter where you go, no matter how deep the depths of your rebellion take you, God is still who he is. He is still a God of mercy. He is still the God of compassion. He is still the God of forgiveness. Jesus didn't waste his life on the cross, but he gave it for your sins. You might have turned your back and run away the other way, but God still loves you, and his desire isn't to destroy you, but his desire is to restore you to that plan he has for your life, because God is still God. Now, there's another part of the story happening here that we sometimes forget about. Because of Jonah's disobedience to God, everybody on the ship was in danger. There is no sin that you commit that only involves you. I hear people say all of the time, well, if I do this, it's only affecting me. Absolutely not. There isn't one sin that you can commit that only affects you. Because of Jonah's disobedience to God, everybody on the ship was in danger. The storm was happening because of Jonah, but he had drawn innocent people into his storm. There isn't a sin that you can commit that only involves you. The consequences of your rebellion are far-reaching. They'll reach into your family and into your children and into your grandchildren. The decisions that you are making today, if they are lousy decisions, are going to affect the people that you say that you love. The consequences of your rebellion will spread throughout your community, all because of you. Your rebellion will put innocent people in danger. Who have you drawn into your storm? How many lives have you jeopardized because you've run away from God? Dad, have you taken your wife and your children into danger because of your rebellion? Mom, have you carried your husband and your children into a mess because you're running away from God? Teenager, what are you doing to your parents? What negative influence are you having on your brothers and your sisters? Who have you drawn into your storm? Everybody was in danger because of Jonah's disobedience. But Jonah was still reluctant to obey. He was on the bottom, and he was planning on staying there, but Jonah had a solution. He said, just pick me up and throw me into the sea, and it'll be calm, and it's my fault, and the storm will come that has come upon us and upon you. It'll go away. You just throw me overboard. Now, that might sound noble at first. Throw me overboard and so you'll be saved, but that wasn't what was on Jonah's mind. You see, Jonah had it all figured out. We're still dealing with his pride here. He had it all figured out. If he was dead, then he didn't have to obey God. Have you ever met people that's that bullheaded? Boy, I have. Related to some of them. Jonah figured if he was dead, then he couldn't preach. And if he didn't preach, then Ninevites wouldn't repent and be saved. If he would die in his death, he could destroy all of them. He's probably thinking of himself as some kind of a martyr, a hero to his hometown. But God is nobody's fool. You might think that you're smart enough to outwit God. You might think that you found a loophole. Your pride might blind you to the place where you think you have it all figured out. But God's about to show you who's boss. God wants to bring you back to where you should be. And in time, he's going to do it. But it may not be under the most pleasant of circumstances. When you're rebellious and you run away from God, he's not going to send a limousine to pick you up. God didn't send a ferry boat to pick up Jonah. He didn't charter a yacht to bring him back. This wasn't the love boat that came to his rescue. But the Bible says that God sent a great fish, and that whale of a fish swallowed Jonah whole. And Jonah, still alive, spent 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale. Now, I've stayed in some nasty places in my lifetime. Have you ever been in the belly of the whale? You ever been in a hospital room, funeral parlor, jail cell? Have you ever been in the belly of the whale? Has God ever locked you up in a place that you can't get out of, that's unpleasant, it's horrible, you don't want to be there? But God gives you time to think and to deal. The Bible says in chapter 2, verse 1, that from the inside of the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord. I think I would have. If you choose to run from God, there'll come a time when God will stop you in your tracks and make you deal with your direction. From inside the belly of the whale, Jonah decided that it was now time to pray. When he was running from God, he didn't want to pray. When he was hiding from God, he didn't want to pray. But now, after 3 days in the bowels of despair, Jonah knew that it was time to get down on his knees and talk to God. Sometimes God's going to send a storm into your life, and he's going to throw you into the sea, and he's going to put you in the belly of the whale until you decide to deal with where you're going. You can run, but you can't hide. And someday God's going to catch up with you and make you deal with your rebellion. He's going to send a storm into your life that will jeopardize everybody around you. Your friends and your family may give up on you and throw you overboard, and God will make you spend time in the belly of the whale, but there is no escaping God. The Bible says that God spoke to the fish. I love this about the Bible. Bible's so plain. People say it's hard to understand. It's not hard to understand. God spoke to the fish, and it vomited out Jonah on the dry land. Now, do I need to go back in Hebrew and reinterpret that for you? God spoke to the fish, and I don't know what he said to it, but it puked. How many of you enjoy doing that? You get the flu, and you know the only way you're going to get better is if you let all of that out, but you just absolutely don't want to do it. But you see, God's got you in this awful place. He's got this awful thing inside of you, and you know you need to get rid of it. So what do? You get down on your knees. You put your face in a place that was not meant for your face. And if that don't make you throw up, nothing will. And then you see your past. Where was I? God spoke to the whale, and it vomited Jonah out upon the dry land, which just goes to show you can't keep a good man down. I knew I shouldn't have done that. But there, on the banks, after 3 days in the belly of the whale, his hair eaten away and his skin bleached by the stomach acids of the whale. His clothes tattered and smelling from the contents of the whale's belly. God said to Jonah, "Jonah, get up and go to Nineveh and preach what I tell you." If you don't know the story, I'm going to let you guess what Jonah did this time. I was thinking about this the other day, and I'm thinking, okay, it would have been one thing for Jonah to go there as he was originally and preach to these people. But imagine this guy comes stumbling up from the beach. He smells like SeaWorld. He has no hair on his body whatsoever. His skin is as white as the pages of your Bible. And he's saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." There'd be people on their knees that didn't even know what he was talking about. God has a plan for your life. And you're never going to be happy and content until you submit yourself to his will. You might be running today, but you can't hide because God's right there with you. You say, "I'm going away. I'm not coming back to church. I'm going somewhere else." Go to your old hangout. God's going to be there. Listen for his voice. Hear what God's saying to your soul. Then get up from where you are and go where God's telling you to go. I really believe that there are people going to be saved here today. All week long, I've seen this coming. God might be telling you need to go to the altar. You've never been there. He might be telling you, you need to go home. It's been a long time. He might be telling you that go to a friend or go to a family member, but wherever he's telling you to go and whatever he's asking you to do, obey him. Obey him because he has a great plan for your life, a divine destiny that is far greater than anything you have ever considered. You might have run and you might have rebelled, but God's hand is still leading you, and his right hand is on you. The Bible says today is the day of salvation, and I really believe that it is. I really believe that it is. I really believe that there are people here today who want to be saved. You've ran away from God your whole life. You'd like to get away from your past, but your pride's been standing in your way. Today's the day. Kneel down here and talk to him. You're going to work it out on your own. You got a plan like Jonah. Down on your knees, talk to God. I believe that people want to be saved. I don't think we have to beg them. I don't think we have to talk them into it. I believe that there are a whole lot of people just waiting for somebody to say, you know, do you know Jesus? I'd like to introduce you, and they'll come running. Today's the day to come running. You need to know our Lord. And folks, I'm talking to seasoned Christians around here. I'm talking to my elders and my staff, and I'm talking to you seasoned Christians around here. You see somebody at this altar needs to know the Lord, get on your knees and pray with them. Show them how to introduce them to Jesus, will you? Will you do that? This altar's not big enough, and it hadn't ought to be big enough. But there's a work that needs to be done today, and God's going to do it. God's going to do it. Father, I pray for your anointing over this invitation. And God, I pray that your will is done completely and thoroughly. God, I pray for every person out here that doesn't know you as their Lord and Savior. God, I pray for those who want to get away from their past. They don't want to be the person that they have been. God, they want a new life in Christ Jesus. And Father, I pray that today will be that day. It'll be the day that they stop running, and it'll be the day that they come home to you. Father, bless this invitation. Might your will be done completely. In Jesus' powerful name, amen.
Thank you for watching today's message from Free Christian Church of God in Continental Ohio. To find out more information about Free Christian Church of God, or to receive a copy of Reverend James Fry's weekly television program, Your Life, call the church office at area code 419-596-3103, or visit our website at freecog.org and download your copy today.